This is Screen Junkies Movie Fights, brought to you by Loot Crate. Now your host, Andy Signore.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to an amazing edition of Movie Fights Live. I'm so excited to have some amazing guests here. We're going to get right to it. The fights are going to be so fun. Today we have what movie would be better if you added zombies in honor of Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies. Also, what movie character should have their own YouTube channel? That's kind of a fun question. And pitch us the next big Fast and the Furious set piece. I'm so excited. He's one of our best pitchers, and I'm going to go to him first. He's here again. He had an amazing first round, and the audience loved him. You were worried, but he's back, and I'm so excited to have him. Mr. Max Landis.
Thank you so much for inviting me back.
Welcome back, sir.
This by far, being on this show, is the only time people have mostly unanimously been happy I existed, even briefly. So I was like, I gotta come back.
I'm so glad you did. I'm glad you had fun, and we had fun having you. Next to him, a friend who I'm so happy to have you. I'm a fan as well. It's Mr. Rob Fee, writer, comedian. Welcome.
Put on your headphones.
Headphones. Thank you. This is my real voice. I don't smoke. I'm not sick. I'm not doing a bit.
What voice?
You sound normal, Rob. Your voice sounds normal.
But my voice died 10 years ago on this very night.
Rob, welcome. A big fan of yours. And you write for a lot of amazing, funny stuff. And welcome to the table. This is going to be fun. I know you're familiar with the show. Next to him, I'm so happy to have him back. Hashtag Botanicus. It's Mike Carlson.
Hi.
Wait, you're not Mike Carlson.
I'm not. Live television, folks.
Well, I don't know if he's trying to Skype in. Mike Carlson was here, but apparently he got his mixed signals crossed and thought it was tomorrow.
Yes.
So Mike is furiously driving to the studio. But I don't know if he's going to make it for the first few rounds. So Dan Murrell was gracious enough to step in. Dan knows what Mike's answers were. And that's what happens on live TV if you're late to movie fights. Dan Murrell's going to step in and attempt to fight the answers that he was given.
I have one sentence descriptions of Mike's answers. I will do justice to them as best I can.
So Dan is only arguing based on Mike Carlson's answers.
To be fair, I'm handicapped too. I'm in a writer's room from like 8 to 8 now. My brain is drained. My answers will suck.
Okay.
Oh, shut up.
So Rob, did you prep or are we all at the same disadvantage?
I'm so high right now.
This is going to be a very fun fight. And I think Mike Carlson is attempting to Skype in while we talk. Let me know if he calls in so we can. No, he's not there yet. Okay. He's mobile. It's harder on a cell phone.
It is hard on a cell phone.
All right. Before we start, I also. Dan was going to be on the fact checking cam, but instead, something happened. So now Mr. Ken Napzok over there is on the fact checking cam.
Hey, I'm just Dan today. I'm just trying to do what Dan does and do it well.
You're going to do a fantastic job. I don't know what's going to happen when Mike comes. I guess we'll have to swat. We'll figure that
It'll
out.
It'll be like the Oscars where Charlton Heston was stuck in traffic and they put, who was it? I don't know. To present Clint Eastwood to present for him. They just swapped
they
out.
Swapped
he ran
out.
In and
he
they swapped him out. I'll just go sit over there and Ken can go.
Back to the booth.
Next to Ken, though, I'm very happy. Guys on the fan cam, it's Mr. James Connery, Lord Karras. Now, James, you're wearing that belt. You're allowed to wear that belt. Dan doesn't let people wear the belt, but do you know why we're letting him wear the belt? He built that belt for us. Fan from home, put that together. We were so impressed. That is now it's become our official next belt on the title. So Dan, of course, allows the belt maker to hold that for him, wearing it proudly. Thank you, man. How did you do that? Thank you for doing it, James. Tell us about it.
I just kind of designed it. I have a friend who does trophy work on the side. Took it in, had him, do this. I wanted to get it laser engraved, but he was like, no, a painted finish would be better etched. So kind of worked with it, pieced it all together. YouTube's a wonderful place to find out information about how to do stuff, and here it is.
If I win, I'm going to spray paint NWO on that.
Well, awesome, dude. Thank you for the belt.
I'm so high.
Thank you for doing it. I'm so happy to have you here. Real quick, before we start, another quick plug. I want to remind everybody, if you hadn't heard, we just announced on SGU, we're doing a new show on SJ Plus. We're doing an after show on The Walking Dead. Now, the reason we're doing this is because Talking Dead isn't honest. Talking Dead has to be so positive on The Walking Dead and everything they said. So introducing Knocking Dead, our new honest after show, where we can do what Chris Hardwick can't, which is tell you when the show sucks and why it sucks. I'm so excited. I'll be hosting that with Hector Navarro and special guests. So I want to make sure you guys all knew Monday on Screen Junkies Plus at 1 p.m. We'll be doing a recap of all Walking Dead. And then starting after the first new episode of season 6, we'll be there every Monday at 1 reacting to the show. So tune in if you're a fan or you just frustrate watch.
I just want to look at it's got its ups and downs. It's peaks and valleys.
And Talking Dead doesn't address the downs. They only talk about the ups. So we'll be doing both. All right, I'm so excited. You guys know how this works. Rob, you're new, but rules. This is based on the argument. It's not based on what I like. Right. It's based on your argument. So you not only got to tell me why your selection is the best, you got to tell me why these fellas, it's going to be hard, why Mike Carl,
by Dan, proxy, why Mike Dan's, is wrong.
Dan, this is not an official Dan fight. This is a Dan stepping in fight. Why these other options aren't right. Right. Makes sense? Any questions before we begin? Love it. Before we do, I have one quick more announcer. I want to thank our sponsor today. They're back again, and we're big fans of them, Loot Crate. They're home of the coolest geek and gamer box supplies, and Dan here is showcasing some of the items from last time. Each month that Loot Crate delivers 6 to 8 curated items around the theme, many of which are exclusive and totally awesome. Look at that. It's a multi-pass.
Multi-pass. Not Corbin. But Lilu Dallas.
Lilu Dallas. What else
came
in?
Space Invader here.
Got an alien.
We have an adorable children's version of one of the most terrifying movie monsters of all time.
My kid has that in his bed. He has no idea what it is, but he thinks it's adorable and soft.
A Space Invader. This I'm going to put in my car. It's like the X-Files.
That is the coolest part of X-Files. That fog line they get. It really pioneered it.
Pretty sure that is just a flashlight.
It is.
It says
X-Files on it.
I love the idea of you're in an earthquake goes, the power goes out, you're like looking around the flashlight, and then you look at it, you're like, man, I love X-Files.
I gotta watch that show, it's back.
Yeah.
If my power was on, I'd be watching it right now.
Each crate shipped to your door for less than $20 a month, so get yourself some loot and support ScreenJunkies in the process. Click the annotation or go to lootcrate.com/moviefights and save 10% off your new subscription by using code MOVIEFIGHTS. Again, lootcrate.com/moviefights, code MOVIEFIGHTS if you have until February 19th at 9 p.m. and you can receive the Dead Crate featuring Deadpool, Walking Dead, and more, so stay tuned. Thank you, Loot Crate, and thank you guys who have supported that to keep us going. All right, I'm ready for this. Let's fight.
Yeah, fuck you!
Fight!
All right, round one, just checking the status of Mike Carlson, who's supposed to be up first.
Oh, sorry, Mike.
I'm going to delay, and I'm gonna change the order here. We're going to go to Max first.
No, go to him first. Let's do it.
We're going to go to Max first. Actually, I have it number, Max first. Max, first question. This comes from Jonathan Youngblood on Twitter, who asks, in honor of Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies, which movie remake would be better with adding zombies? So the guys here is, pick a movie that would be better to reboot or redo using zombies. And we're going to go to you, Max, first. What did you pick?
So when I thought about this, originally I was thinking of only good movies or movies I enjoyed, and then I remembered that the only movies that you should reboot or remake are movies with a good idea that didn't work perfectly the first time. And I thought about trailers. Like, if I heard it was this with zombies, would I be excited or would I be pissed off that they rebooted it and added zombies? And I realized there was only one movie that I felt could gain substantially from the addition of a stakes, a threat, an ongoing danger, and that is Richard Linklater's Boyhood. I feel that Boyhood as a movie is an amazing cinematic experiment, but ultimately does not come together. It's boring, it's indulgent, and I think a lot of people feel this way. If you love Boyhood, I don't think you're wrong. It took 13 years, but you know, like at the same time, who cares? Nothing in that movie is propulsive. Imagine if that movie begins with a little boy growing up in a zombie apocalypse, and then throughout the movie, the subtext of watching a young man come of age is the world either falling apart or coming back together. This adds stakes. This adds tension. Don't you fucking want to see a good drama about a kid growing up in a post-zombie apocalypse world? It's not a zombie apocalypse movie. It's a coming-of-age drama about a kid set in a world where there's fucking zombies everywhere. Oh, and by the way, the kid really ages 13 years during the movie. Suddenly, Ethan Hawke has a reason to be in that movie.
I was wondering, you are keeping the aging happening.
Of course, it's Boyhood. No, I'm doing exactly Boyhood, except for the context of there's fucking zombies everywhere, characters are dying, death is a constant presence. And because a big theme in that movie is aging and getting older, why not address when zombies are best metatextually used? They represent, the human tragedy of death, aging, the denial of death, the idea of becoming dead, the death of individuality. You know, there's such subtext there. And honestly, with Richard Linklater at the helm, I think we all know that that guy's a master director when he's at his best. And just my ABC argument is, don't you fucking want to see Richard Linklater direct a zombie movie?
All right, I'm definitely interested. We're going next to Rob. Rob, what was your pick?
I went with My Girl.
Yep, Anna Klumsky and Macaulay Culkin, yep.
And here's why. That movie is boring as hell, but it's about a little girl that lives in a funeral home growing up and experiencing life. How much better would it be getting your period for the first time, oh, and also being chased by zombies? Like, that would be amazing.
Well, because it can smell blood.
It can smell blood.
I assume that was on purpose, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Girls always have their period on purpose.
I'm not going to casually bring up getting your period for the first time unless there's a reason. But then at the end when Thomas J. dies, or best friend, spoiler alert, Thomas J. dies, he gets attacked by the bees and dies. During his funeral in the house, he comes back and starts trying to kill her again. And the bees come back and start killing her. There's zombie bees in this, too.
Zombies.
Zombie.
Now that's a movie.
I would watch that movie. I would watch that movie all day, every day.
All right. We're starting strong. Mr. Mike Carlson.
All right.
Through Dan Murrell.
This is an idea.
What did Mike Carlson pick?
I have to channel Mike Carlson right now. This is an idea I'm very excited about. It's called Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, and Also There Are Zombies. Listen, we know Wayne Szalinski. He's a mad scientist. He's a wacky, crazy mad scientist. Rick Moranis, we all loved him. It was a big movie from our childhood. So imagine a world where Wayne Szalinski shrunk his kids and also simultaneously accidentally and also shrunk zombies. So it's not just a bunch of kids versus a big ant. It's a bunch of kids and a big ant and a lot of also versus a lot of zombies and a lawnmower. It's insane. It's all the insanity you wanted from a Honey, I Shrunk the Kids movie and all the peril you wanted from Night of the Living Dead mashed into one movie.
So the zombies were just hanging out in his house.
No, here's what happened.
How many zombies did he shrink?
Here's what happened. I'll tell you exactly what happened. In his attic laboratory, he's working on his shrinking machine. Right next to it, he's working on a reanimation project. And then through some wacky mishap, the shrinking ray and the animation projects merged and happened to both also activate at the same time. So he simultaneously created zombies and shrunk them, but also at the same time, his kids were also in front of the shrinking ray. It's just a mishmash of misunderstandings and bad circumstances.
What if you made a device that could bring people back from the dead successfully, but they were this big?
They were tiny.
They only come back small.
Oh, your husband died? We brought him back.
All right, I want to open up the fight, but I also want you at home at hashtag movie fights live. Tell us which movie you like, because I want Ken to police this. But go ahead, guys. Which one's the wrong movie here?
Well, you know what else is with this too? Having to combine both of those, like two jobs into one, just shows the state of America right now and what Obama's done to our country. Cutting jobs and, my God.
Well, how about
we can't
this?
Can't handle four more years.
Trump would have made those zombies huge.
Let's say your
biggest zombies.
Let's say your relative dies out of state. What's the most difficult part of perhaps transporting them if they were on vacation? To lay in their final resting place, you have to arrange the transportation and whatnot, but not if you shrink them down into a matchbox-sized coffin, and then when you get to your destination, you then re-enlarge them. And anyway, there's any number of wacky misunderstandings.
That's one of the biggest complaints people have about funerals is that, man, I wish the coffin
transport
was
costs.
Well, let me just come at both of your guys' movies. Mm-hmm. First of all, both of your guys' movies are sound funny. They're funny joke ideas for a movie plus zombies. My idea, I went at this totally sincere. I actually want to see a version of Boyhood with zombies because I thought Boyhood was lacking something. Whereas My Girl, I don't think it's boring. I think it's good. And fucking Honey, I Shrunk the Kids is a classic. I don't want to risk fucking up those movies. I'll risk fucking up Boyhood.
I don't want to wait 13 years for another Boyhood movie though with zombies. However,
I didn't hear it was a reboot. Yeah. I heard it was adding zombies to the movie as it exists.
Well, which movie remake would be made better?
Oh, okay.
Let's assume.
Remaking it again would be. Doesn't the word remake mean?
I didn't see.
Redo the movie. Yes, I'll take. Okay, yes, redo your movie, but with zombies, which I think you both are implying. Yours would still be more exciting. With
Excuse me. Hers had Macaulay Culkin.
Because you said yours was boring. So yes, to define the question, if you were to redo the movie over with, how would you do it? So yes. So your point being, yours is more interesting. Is that true? Do you guys think Boyhood is more interesting than the other two movies?
Well, I think we're getting it because Walking Dead's going to run for 15 years, and Carl will be 30 by the time that show ends. So I think at the end of it, you're going to get your Boyhood zombie movie because you're going to get to watch Carl grow up on television, and you can just binge it.
I think the idea of watching, like Dan Aykroyd was great watching him fight Ghost. Now watching him fight zombies would be even better.
Oh, God.
Listen, I love wacky hijinks. One of my favorite things about Honey, I Shrunk the Kids was that it was a kids' movie that had actual stakes in it. That was a genuinely frightening movie.
Remember when they used to have those?
Yeah, when they had kids' movies that they weren't afraid to get dark. Kids
almost
died.
Remember when the ant died?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
What if the zombie
traumatizing.
Bit
they
the
ripped
ant,
that off in this.
And then you have, not only have zombies, you have zombants. You have zombants, you've got zombies, you have tiny kids, you still have the cereal thing, I think. It's,
guys, as silly as it sounded, I need to hear some more aid. Why is this not a good movie?
Do you want me to be honest
yes,
with you?
Please.
Because every time they do PG or PG-13 zombies, it fucking sucks.
All right.
The end. The end. It's never right. It's going to be in Pride and Prejudice versus Zombies. Watch there be like no splatter. Watch there be no actually brutal kills. Watch it feel as antiseptic as that movie about the zombie that falls in love with a girl where they don't really eat anyone.
God.
Yeah. Whenever you do PG or PG-13 zombies, they cut the balls right off of them. There's a reason every zombie movie is rated R. And I think Richard Linklater would make an R-rated zombie movie as Boyhood. Whereas I don't think Honey, I Shrunk the Kids is ever an R-rated movie.
My girl is going hard R. Hard R.
My girl is always going hard R. That's why she's my girl.
So your version of my girl is a hard R with
hard
the zombies.
R. I mean,
we really see in that period.
Oh,
you see what he did? He created this. This is his doing.
But there is a scene where, because her mom died, and so that's what, you know, caused her to kind of have all these issues of not being able to identify and all this. The zombie mom comes back, so she has to decide, like, it's a very emotional
scene. The pet cemetery.
Yeah.
The old
you
pet
have to decide,
cemetery.
Do I want the shadow of who my mom used to be, or do I kill it and keep it from killing me and my dad
and
Macaulay Culkin?
All I'm saying is you have any number of hard R zombie movies. I could name you 50 hard R zombie movies. How many zombie movies have you ever seen that involve wacky hijinks with kids shrunk down to insect size and also zombies?
I'm going to say there's a reason we've never seen that.
I'm going to say none. I'm going to give it a chance. I would like to see a new Rick Moranis vehicle starring zombies also.
If we're doing a Rick
Moranis
zombie
movie, don't cheat and bring Rick Moranis in as your fucking trump card.
Listen,
you are by doing this, you are destroying Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
Oh, never.
If you're doing a Rick Moranis zombie movie, it's got to be Little Giants, though.
Well, unfortunately, I didn't have the latitude to pick my Rick Moranis vehicle. Like,
Little Giants is a better title,
Little
though.
Little Giants
on this one.
Is for zombies, I agree. But I'm saying, let's see a truly unique movie. Let's see kids battling zombants and zombies and shrinking all at the same time.
Little Giants would
last
have been
thoughts.
A title for Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, too.
Yeah. I'm using that as your closing, Dan. Last thoughts, Rob. Yeah.
Honey, I Shrunk the Little Giants. Another tie.
Dan Aykroyd versus zombies all day. I'd watch that forever.
Beautifully shot zombie film about growing up in a post-apocalyptic world, directed by Richard Linklater.
All right, Ken, I need your help over there. What do the audience want to see, and what do you got over there for fact checking?
Well, I can't fact check this unless I'm on E. So, the audience, I'll tell you what, a lot of people really like Max Landis' pitches for Boyhood, and everything's getting there. We got Ashley Davis is saying, Max, your hair is awesome. I would so watch Boyhood with zombies. Very interesting take. Boyhood X, they're calling it.
Oh, hell yeah, Boyhood X.
Chris Zimmerman out there, though, he says, how about we see How to Lose a Zombie in 10 Days, Please? But a lot of people gravitating towards Boyhood for that round.
Great. Based on those arguments, I think you did bring it on us and you did bring a take. It was the hard R. Your movie was. It's the fact that you don't want to ruin the other two. I was waiting for you to defend Boyhood a little bit because I know you love it.
I'm not fighting as me. I'm not fighting as me.
Fair enough.
I'm fighting as Mike. I wanted to say a lot of things, but I'm fighting as Mike.
All right. Mike didn't defend Boyhood, so therefore Max is gonna get the first point.
Yeah. They told me I did a thing about show running, and they were like, strike poses that show power. And one of the poses was this. And I was like, so like casually in a writer's room, I keep doing this. And I showed everyone the document. And so now when I do it, we all do it. That's not a story. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, everyone.
Now we know.
I'm sorry.
Now we know when we win. Round two. Still no word from Mike Carlson.
I am in communication with him.
He's not Skyping in.
Not yet. Yeah,
but he's en route.
He is en route.
Okay. I'm sorry, Mike. I failed you on that one.
We'll see how he does. Round two. Vin Diesel has announced the release dates for Fast and the Furious 9, 10, 8, 9, and 10. So they're going for another trilogy. Now, this movie is always filled with iconic set pieces, big stunty action scenes. And the last one, whether you like the movie or not, you can't knock the fact that Vin Diesel drove a car through two buildings, which was pretty insane and fun. So we want you guys to pitch us the next big action set piece in one of the future Fast and the Furious franchise movies. And we're starting with you, Rob. What was your pitch?
Here we go. So this is 9. This is after 8 that's already coming out.
Got it.
At this point, The Rock is so big, he can barely fit on camera. They have to do aerial shots just to show him. He can't fit into most, you know, SUVs, smaller cars he can't fit in. So he's on top of an SUV. Vin Diesel's driving. Stone Cold Steve Austin's in the passenger seat because he joined. He was a Border Patrol agent that's had enough and wants to play by his own rules. And he's in the passenger seat. They drive. Kid Rock is in the back seat playing Ba Wa Da Ba live because it's in the budget. They drive through the Lincoln Monument for no reason whatsoever. They robbed a Fifth Third Bank. They drive through the Lincoln Monument. As they do, missiles come out from under the bottom of the Lincoln Monument that no one knew was there until now. They go into space, and the car explodes. Everyone's like, Michelle Rodriguez gets her memory back. It's like, oh my God, that was my boyfriend and he died. Everyone's mourning them. Everyone thinks they're gone. All of a sudden in the distance during the funeral, they hear, bah, what the, bah, the bang, the bang, bang. And all of a sudden, Vin Diesel, Steve Austin, and the giant rock come down, boom. Like the Avengers hit the ground, and that sets up for Fast and Furious 10.
Wow. All right. Are we close on... do we have an ETA on Mike?
Not yet.
Max go next, because I'm sure he'll give a little some long and give him one more shot.
Otherwise, I want them, when they come down on... There's a stage,
right.
And Kid Rock's whole band is playing, right. And they're on the front of the stage throwing out T-shirts to the people at their own funerals. Okay, so
what's
sorry,
your pitch?
Mine isn't going to be a joke.
Okay.
So
is that a joke? Did you see the last one? That's pretty much what happened at the end.
No, the last one was amazing.
I love the last one.
I'm going to do a variation of the themes that have started to be raised in the Fast and the Furious films, which one of the problems with the Fast and Furious films is outside of Statham, the villains aren't terrifically memorable. I'm going to do a villain who shows up in 8 and lasts for 3 movies. He's his own trilogy. The Fast and Furious movies were originally about people stealing cars and illegal street racing, modding up cars, undercover detective work. They have gradually become about a group of international mercenaries, or what even would you call their team of weirdos?
They're criminals, but we kind of like them.
They're criminals, but they do in the big jobs to fight the bad people. Okay, so what I want is for them to piss off James Bond. Not the James Bond, but a character who clearly is James Bond, played by who do you like? You like Benedict Cumberbatch? You like Benedict Cumberbatch as a James Bond-esque character? Okay, so he has the Aston Martin. He has a car that has all the fucking gadgets, that has the smoke, that has all the shit. And their final confrontation with him is on those, you know, is it in Italy? I think it's in Calabria. You've seen it in movies 1,000 times. That road that goes down the side of the mountain that goes this way and then 90-degree angle that way, 90-degree angle that way, 90-degree angle that way. Their final chase with him is the whole cast in cars chasing him. He's going to get away. His car can spring and flip over. It can shoot rockets and acid and nets and oil and fire and jets, and it has a rotor. It can go up in the air. So at first they're chasing him on this, and he is Pac-Maning from level to level as they're trying to get him. Takes out Rock. Takes out Stone Cold Steve Austin, who's also in this movie because he survived the last one. Takes out fucking Letty. Takes out everyone. Finally, it's just Dom and him. And Dom's car, they finally get off of that area, and they're down by the water, and they're driving through the fucking surf. So water's going over his car. The fucking spy car is the fucking shit. It can take any kind of hit imaginable. But Dom's car is falling apart. It's like the fucking Bluesmobile at the end of the movie. First the hood goes, then the door goes, then the roof goes. You got Vin Diesel. He looks like fucking Snidely Whiplash behind this like little thing. It's just an engine and a fucking rotor, but it fucking looks great, and it's a practical stunt. So it's terrifying. He then has to climb over. When he gets close enough, his own engine. He has to climb over his own engine as it's going and turning. And meanwhile, Jude Law, or whoever it is, Benedict Cumberbatch, gets out of the car and is shooting at him on the skeleton of his car, because his car can drive itself, self-driving cars. That's what the whole movie is about, is someone who's going to hack all of the self-driving cars in the city, because driving has just been
Tesla,
made illegal.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, driving's been made illegal. They're going to hack all of the cars and make them drive into the ocean. The greatest act of terrorism, and not a shot fired. But anyway, so he's climbing over his own motor. Jude Law shoots the motor. It explodes. Dom gets impaled through here, but it doesn't matter because he has so much muscle mass that he can't feel it. So he just jumps onto Jude Law's spy car, pushes him over the hood so he gets run over by the car. In the next movie, Vin Diesel has the Jude Law spy car.
Mm.
I don't know what the fuck that was.
But I like the addition of the spy car. Okay.
Oh, no, no. A spy car taking out like 20 cars in a chase where we're rooting for the people who are in the normal cars hasn't been done in a movie yet.
Or, yeah, and especially in that movie, that's an interesting car to add. All right. We're ready for Mike Carlson. I'm just checking. Is he, unless he's walking in the building.
Not yet. Not yet. We're in communication, but
okay,
no.
Okay, but
no
he's not listening or either. Okay, Dan, yeah. You're a little bit of a you have to give me a Mike Carlson pitch.
Mike is so good at these. The first two were his pitch questions. I feel so bad. Okay. Next big set piece for Vin Diesel. This is gonna be a three movie epic because this is good. This is an epic. There's an organized crime syndicate that's hitting everywhere around the world. They recruit Vin and the boys. Let's say Kurt Russell's back to find him, but they can't find this underground crime syndicate anywhere. Turns out they're housed in a secret location at the center of the earth. Vin Diesel revs up the car. He's got to have the one liner. Turns out to solve a problem, you gotta cut it to the core. Boom! Cut to Vin Diesel flying into an active volcano. He goes through the volcano straight to the center of the earth. He meets everybody down there. Brendan Fraser from Journey to the Center of the Earth is down there. Hilary Swank from The Core is down there. Everybody's down there, and it's just like a three movie Mordor fight.
The Fast and Furious Extended Universe also contains the movie The Core
and Journey to the Center of the Earth with Brendan Fraser. They're fighting down there. Let's throw
crab
in
people from South Park.
The animated Saddam Hussein people. From South Park. Let's bring back CGI Donald Pleasance as Blofeld from James Bond. Why not? It's a three movie epic fight in the middle of the Earth's core. At the end of it, they set off a nuclear bomb. Why not? Vin Diesel gets blasted into the space, and the post-credits scene is the first scene from Pitch Black. Boom!
Wow. Guys, this is tough. All right. Any addition to fights here?
You had Kid Rock, Bala Daba to anything, and I'm pumped. I'm buying a ticket to that movie. Automatically.
That's just because your dad's Kid Rock.
I mean, yeah, but like, that's because
you're
see my dad.
You're Joe C. You grew up. Joe C. grew up in Journey.
Oh, now
to
the
you.
Voice makes sense.
I just got to say again, I sincerely pitched a scene. I did not try to make everybody laugh. I pitched a scene I want to see in a movie. I recognize this is an entertainment show, but I take my movie fights very seriously. And I want to see Dom. The Rock is the start of it, but in the Fast and Furious movies, which, by the way, are very good. Fast and Furious 7 is better than Force Awakens by, like, a lot.
Absolutely.
And, like, it's so much fun and involving... I cried.
That ending was pretty...
Yeah, I like...
Who would have thought they would have pulled that off as well as they did?
And by the way, even if Paul Walker hadn't died, I probably would have cried during that.
But it definitely helped.
I didn't know Paul Walker.
The scene where she... Like, when he's trying to make Michelle Rodriguez get her memory, and she was like, why didn't you tell me? What was the line? Like... why didn't you tell me about us? And I can't remember, it was something like, because you can't tell somebody to love you.
Yeah.
I was like, that's a good line. Well, that's a really good line.
Now that we've gotten there, I want to see Dom be vulnerable. I want to see him fight someone. I want there to be a scene in my Fast and Furious before this chase where a guy a third his size just beats the shit out of him and Dom can't even lay a punch on James Bond and like emasculates him. And then at the end, no, fuck you. You can have all the training. You can have all the cars. But you know what Dom has? Heart and family.
And mine, Ja Rule is back too.
Oh, hell yeah.
All right. I don't know how much that helps, but...
And Lil Bow Wow.
I may be on Bow Wow, but Ja Rule is 100%.
Also at the center of the earth, Jules Verne, Doc Brown and Clara from Back to the Future 3, and the Mole Men from Fantastic Four.
Mike fights a little bit in the second part of the fight.
I'm legitimately pitching who else is down there, but no, I will argue why this is the best concept. Because
Heath Ledger, Joker, young Michael Fox, they're all there.
They're all there. What was the best Fast and Furious movie? What's the one that everyone loves the most? It's Fast 5. That's the one everyone loves the most.
Seven.
People respect Furious 7 because at the end it got very heartfelt.
Five,
But before that, Furious 7 was a bit of a snoozer. It was the same Fast and Furious movie we've seen, but they were able to wrap it up very nicely and add a nice little bow. Fast 5 was the one with the Rock. And the reason I like it is because it ended with them pulling a safe through the streets. It was the most ridiculous one, and that's why people like it, because this is a ridiculous franchise. They did the serious thing, and they did it very well with Paul Walker. I want to see them go batshit crazy. I want to see them go so crazy that people go just to see what's happening. They don't even care about what happens in the movie. They said, this sounds so insane. I have to go see this. I have no choice but to go see this. The crazier, the better.
Yeah, but you can't just throw a million licensed characters into your pitch and then be like, that's my pitch.
It worked for Lego. Lego movie was great. It had every licensed character ever in it. It's just like a live action version of the Lego movie set in the center of the earth.
Yeah, but you're not okay.
Mine ends with a what they think
cheating.
Is a funeral, but with Bawa Daba coming from space.
Heaven.
That's too soon.
All right.
Too soon.
Ken, what are they saying? What are they saying on the board?
They're saying a lot. I was trying to fact check that road max. Do you mean Stelvio Pass in Italy? It's the one with all the...
Down.
Yes, I think that's the one. But yes, that exists. No tunnels in the Lincoln Memorial that I can find. A lot of people chatting in. They actually they want a swearwood count for this game. Also, Zane wants Andy to reward a point for everyone in this round because all the answers are pretty crazy. Holmesy pitched a good idea about everyone in a bus goes over a cliff and blows up. Everyone dies except for the Rock, whose baby oil stopped him burning. But a lot of people just enjoying this round. A lot of comedy in this.
Movie Fights, hashtag Movie Fights Live if you're watching with us now. It's Movie Fights. I gotta listen to your arguments. As fun as some of them were, I think Max is correct. There was only one legit fight there, and I don't understand why Hillary Swank from the Core would be there, as funny as it was, Mike.
Listen, nobody's fighting style is more different from my own than Mike's.
Well, you don't. You
I
don't,
was trying to go.
I don't want to hear Grumpy
crazy.
Dan. I want to hear Mike.
No. What did you say, Mike?
I'm just saying.
What did you say, Mike?
I think that Mike would go as crazy as he could possibly go.
I don't disagree. And so for that reason alone, we got to give Max the point. He's up to two. Good job there. All right. Let me know if he's close, because if he gets here by round three, he might still have a shot. Oh, he's on the phone. Mike, has he been listening?
I've been listening a little.
Oh, no.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry, Mike.
Dan, are you close? What's your ETA, Mike?
I can't bring up Waze and Skype at the same time.
Is he driving?
10 minutes.
Or what if we witness his death?
We just saw you. Please don't crash.
Please be safe, Mike.
What's the opposite of Fast and Furious?
I almost crashed trying to figure out the Skype.
Please don't do that. So just to prove Mike is on his way, let me know. Listen in and keep listening in as we go. Did you hear any of Dan's pitches, and how was that pitch okay?
I only heard a very detail end, but knowing Dan, he is a genius at pitching, and I think it was probably amazing.
Yes, he did a very good job in your absence. All right, well, keep listening. Hopefully you get here before so you can fight round three, or if you'd like to chime in to help Dan or go instead of him, I'll allow it because I don't think it'll be that much of an advantage. Rob and Max, don't worry, because he's driving in a car. All right, round three. Question, what movie character do you wish most had their own YouTube channel? Now, what's this mean? You know what YouTube channels, vlogs, videos, etc. Which movie character would you want to hear more from? And I'm starting with you, Rob.
Well, this one was very easy. I went with Air Bud because, first of all, pet stuff. Like, you're going to click on a pet video immediately. If it's a baby or an animal, you're going to watch it. But this isn't like your run-of-the-mill regular dog. This dog has won basketball championships. This dog can play football. This dog can play volleyball. This dog can play soccer. Like, this is an unstoppable dog. I like to imagine what it was like, though, when he signed onto the basketball team, that they had to cut someone from that team to make a roster spot. Like, when that kid went home, his dad definitely beat him with a belt. Because no dad is proud of you for getting cut for a golden retriever. But I mean, that's better than any Vine video. There would be nothing more entertaining than watching this dog play every sport better than, it's like Steph Curry as a dog. I would watch that all day.
What's the line? Steph Curry with the shot. Steph Curry, but a dog. Imagine Drake saying that. Imagine Drake's, once the dog gets really popular, Drake's song about Air Bud's YouTube channel.
And he's in music videos and just standing in the background.
All right, Max, what's your pitch? Whose YouTube channel do you want to see?
I thought about it a lot, and I had a bunch of different answers, and I settled on one, which was the only character who I've seen create really good viral content, which is the Joker, as portrayed by Heath Ledger in the film Dark Knight. His video of him torturing the guy, "Look at me," is my favorite scene in that movie, or among them. He's only in that movie for like 12 minutes. We all wanted more of him. Every other part of that movie that didn't have him in it was boring. So I'm down for weekly updates of him causing chaos and destruction. And also, like, just blogs about, like, how he's feeling and how he does his makeup. I'd like a makeup tutorial. But honestly, I think it would be very exciting to be able to get more of a window into that character's life. If that had been viral content to promote the movie, everybody would have fucking loved it.
All right, Mike Carlson and Dan Murrell, let's hear your pick.
Mike, do you want to pitch it or should I?
If you can hear me, I'll pitch it.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, we can hear you. All
right. God.
All right, here we go. I think we should go back to what the internet was built on, and that is people having accidents. People getting hurt, people getting hit in the balls, people falling from things, and that's why I have chosen Kevin McAllister from Home Alone for his own YouTube channel.
Okay.
Okay. Now, in my future, Kevin McAllister is not some sort of sad kid. He owns, like, a very successful home invasion company. All right. He has a very fun way of protecting people's homes, and I feel like he's going to utilize this to its full potential by placing little GoPro cameras in all of these different places. And we are going to get some of the greatest pratfalls in the history of pratfalls. And the YouTube, they're going to go nuts for it. People are going to love it.
You're upside down on our screen, Mike. That's funny for us to watch.
Live TV, folks.
I love this. This is my favorite thing ever.
I believe that's the Saw movies.
Yeah, that's the Saw films.
Okay. That was a good pitch. All right, let's hear the fight.
Well, that's the pitch for Saw 3, is exactly what that movie is. I mean, we're talking, this isn't even an argument. We're talking about a dog that can play sports on the internet. Like, that's what the internet was built on, that and hardcore pornography.
You know, it's interesting. When you first did this, my argument against you was there's a million videos of funny animal things. I've seen a dog play basketball. I've seen a dog play baseball. I've seen a dog play hockey. But then I realized what I haven't seen was a whole game where a dog beats humans, and specifically beats befuddled, helpless, potentially crying, dazed human children who can't fucking believe this is happening to them. And this is a life-ruining experience.
Oh, absolutely.
Which is like the best type of fail.
Absolutely.
Like, the video isn't even amazing dog win. It's whole team of human children fail.
Absolutely.
I never realized that. And
wow, you're helping his argument there.
Well,
careful.
Now I just really want to see it.
Mike and Dan. Well,
here's the problem with Air Bud, and I don't mean to be morbid, but that channel has an expiration date. And you know exactly how long that's going to be around, 12, 13 years. It's going to be very tragic when you lose it. And the Joker is a very scary person, and the last thing I want to see is a webcam video of him going
expired.
Like...
I just want to address the haters for a second. You guys have been leaving me some really nasty comments below.
See, I don't believe Joker
Reads. Calling me fake and saying that I've got professionals doing my makeup.
Like, that's the reason that he's so great is because he's so mysterious. I don't want to be like,
I'm going to do this vlog now.
I'm going to put something out there. The Joker, as we saw him in that film, I believe would curate amazing YouTube content. I think it would be incredible stuff. I mean, most of his crimes in that film border on performance art, and him taking us inside one of those, just because we imagine him to be a YouTuber, the way he was presentational, the way the Joker has always been written as theatrical and more invested in other people's opinion of him than he is in actually achieving anything meaningful. His nihilism is, of course, a front. Joker's nihilism is absurd. If he actually didn't care about anything, he'd be nude. He wouldn't spend all this money on fucking suits. Everything on him is custom. Oh yeah, that guy really doesn't care about anything. Yeah, you're carrying 1,000 knives. The myth of the Joker as a man without a plan is torn away the second you investigate any of his behavior. He is someone who is wonderful at manipulating an audience, and I am down to be manipulated by him. Just call me Harleen Quinzel.
Yeah, but all the comments would all just be fake.
Can you imagine? No,
he'd come find them. He'd do what I always want to do, which is give them electric shocks whenever they say something mean to me.
Imagine how terrifying it would have been when Air Bud was playing football if someone tackled him. That would have been horrifying. That's horrific.
Mike, do you have anything to say?
Yeah, I was going to say, like, can the Joker, though, was he going to produce content at a rate? Is he going to deliver a weekly deadline? That's the thing. I don't see this guy coming in. You know, Screen Junkies, we know it's got to be at the same time every week. People are going to want content.
I think if anybody's talking about meeting a deadline and being on time, it is not you.
That's a low blow.
Look, he's upside down in his car.
In my car.
This is one of my favorite fights ever, Mike.
He's driving. He's doing the Fast and the Furious stunt. He's driving on the roof. Driving upside down. What if you see people passing under him?
Can you give us, like, your flying upside down motion? Let's cut back. Here he comes. Whoa! Are you close, Mike?
I'm by the Beverly Center.
So no.
He is. He's like 10 minutes away. That's close.
Well,
that's close.
Not bad. All right. Time's up. Round three. Time's up. All right. Ken, anything to add there from the comments? #MoviesLive.
Yeah, a lot of people are saying there was a Disney show called Dog with a Blog, and it was atrocious, but that shouldn't factor into this.
There was a Disney show called Dog with a Blog.
I looked it up. It was legit. It was a sitcom told from the family dog Stan's point of view.
Did that dog play basketball?
He didn't, though, so he didn't have a sport.
Get out of here with that. I don't care about Dog with a Blog.
Other suggestions, The Dude, Star-Lord, Nikki Baldwin says L. Woods from Legally Blonde, a Deadpool getting a lot of.
Elle Woods is a great idea.
Yeah, she said she'd do. She'd be versatile. Fashion tips, legal advice, would be all over there.
That's basically everyone on YouTube right now.
Other than that, everyone.
It's so exciting, it'd be well written if it's from Legally Blonde.
Everyone just wants Mike to get here safe.
Yes, please get here safe, Mike. All right, I'm glad we can hear you now too. All right, based on the arguments, I think there's nothing more than a dog playing sports that we want to see. I think, Rob, you had some really good arguments there, and even you started turning a little bit, Max, so that didn't help your case. So, and then I needed to hear a little bit more about what this home invasion thing was, but it still was a little confusing, but I think it's hard to beat a dog beating everyone in an entire game of sports. So Rob gets the point.
This is the move.
Yeah, your power pose. Project confidence.
All right, round four. All right, Mike, are you there?
Yes.
All right. Are you ready to pitch your alien pitch? I'm going to set the question up, but tell me afterwards if you're ready or if you want Dan to do it.
What cell phone provider do you use?
It's Sprint. Sprint is the worst.
All right. Noomi repeats.
This episode of Movie Fights not brought to you by Sprint.
They're the nation's third largest provider by accident.
Noomi repeats will not be back for Alien Covenant, which is the Prometheus sequel. So that means Michael Fassbender is the only one coming back. David, right? That was his name?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yes.
Coming back from the first movie to continue. So Jexy MG on Twitter asked us, pitch us the best Prometheus sequel.
Cool.
And how far are you, Mike? Because if you're close, what's the distance? I might try and put you last. Otherwise, I might pitch you first. Where are you now?
I don't know his pitch.
I can go quick. Are you near? Can you hear me?
Yeah, let's hear you. Go ahead. Pitch it. Go ahead, Mike.
All right, I'm going to be quick. All right, so we need to see something that's probably a sequel to Prometheus. We saw a little bit at the end of like a traditional alien that we all remember, we all love. I want to see that alien's life. I want to see a version of that, almost like Wall-E, where that thing is just kind of going around the universe. It's not speaking, and then he meets another alien and he falls in love. But obviously the twist with this is he eventually is going to eat the girlfriend he has, and it's going to be really deadly, and it's going to turn very violent, and it's going to be this beautiful but very incredibly dark, evil story about that alien existing on different planets in the universe.
And the alien, sorry, and the alien's eating his girlfriend. The alien has a girlfriend? Did anyone catch that? We lost him.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, the alien has a girlfriend who he eats.
Got it. That's what I thought. Okay, so yeah. You're in and out. Dan, now you know his pitch. If we lose him, you can now know what you're defending. All right. Max, let's hear your pitch.
Uh-oh.
Oh, here we go.
Uh-oh.
The title of the sequel to Prometheus being Alien Covenant implies that it is another story from the same world and therefore potentially not a direct sequel any more than Prometheus was a direct sequel to Aliens vs. Predator 2, all of which taking place in the same cinematic universe. So let's go. I want to take you back to the Deep BC. We establish in Prometheus that the engineers built our planet from dust. Of course, it doesn't make any sense when it happens, but then we establish in Aliens vs. Predator that aliens have actually been on our Earth since ancient times when we go to that big temple. Well, I want to take you 1,000 years before even that, and I want to pitch you a movie directed by Ridley Scott, because he's good at directing this type of movie. He's been experimenting, but I want to take you back to the Deep BC, pre-fire, the dawn of man, when we lived in tribes and still had to compete with Neanderthals for food. And I want to take you to two warring clans of humans. They don't even speak yet. They wear loincloths. These are the original cavemen. They are the first Homo erectus. They communicate mainly in grunts and symbols, and you get amazing actors to play these people. There's warring clans, they're fighting over food, they're hunting mammoth, they're Neanderthal in the valley who are bigger than them and we're trying to steal from them. It's a family drama with tremendous pathos. And then the youngest finds something in the woods. What you have here is an open world remake of the original Alien. One alien versus humans who don't have flamethrowers, don't have guns, don't have lingual communication. How are they going to protect themselves? You have a movie that looks like The Revenant in scope and beauty taking place on a primeval Earth that plays like a homespun version of Predator with grandeur and beauty of the primeval world pitting human against a predator, which of course would be the xenomorphs as featured in Aliens. You bring back the H.R. Giger psychosexuality, the animalistic nature of the alien, the fact that they represent both penis, vagina, birth, death. All of these things are elemental in the series, and they come up again and again. Motherhood, penetration, the idea of having things stolen away from you happens again and again in the Alien series. They're thematic touchstones. The Alien movies are about alienation. They all take place in extremely isolated places. And every time we try to put him with a bunch of people around, it gets really fucking stupid, as evidenced in Aliens vs. Predator 2, because they don't work. We know that guns kill them. Well, I want to take away your gun. I want to give you a spear and a bow and arrow and pitch you against a monster that moves faster than humans, thinks like a fucking shark, and runs at about 80 miles an hour. And by the way, it can rip you in half just by grabbing you and doing that. I think there's something really incredible here. I think there's a powerful horror adventure movie, and I think it could be emotional, evocative, thrilling, and universal on a human level.
Ooh, all right, Rob, follow that.
Well, I was going to do a real answer, but I'm not going to do one like that, so here's the joke answer. So David is left on the planet. He's the last one.
David.
Last one there. Was he just ahead?
Yeah, he was just ahead.
Yeah, so he's asleep on the planet. What we don't know is that all of his friends back home, it's in 2 days, it's his wedding. And so...
You're a robot!
And so robots can get married. That is so robophobic to say that they can't get married. So his wedding's in 2 days.
I thought that was really funny.
Thank you. His wedding's in 2 days. All of a sudden, they're planning this big bachelor party for him. They can't find him. They have no idea where he was. because they got really wasted.
Yes!
So they can't tell his robot fiance what happened, where he is. So now they're going all through space, trying to retrack their steps to see where they lost David. They run into a space tiger. They run into a space naked Chinese man.
They run into
space Mike Tyson. Yep. Until finally they find him. Then at the end, the story's all wrapped up by some wacky, crazy photographs during the closing credits with full frontal nudity.
You know, I don't think you need the alien element. I think you could sell that story on its own. But could you set it in Bangkok?
Well, I'd like to do that movie and then the sequel do the exact same thing again.
All right, Mike Carlson, what do you think?
I think
is he here?
I'm stalling because I think he's...
Is he here?
He's coming up in the elevator. I think your concept sounds interesting. It might, I don't know about the Android angle. It might work once. I don't know if it would work multiple times. But,
I feel like you could do it maybe thrice.
I don't know. I don't think it would hold up. but yeah, I think, you know, do you need another serious alien movie? I think that I'm going to get up out of my chair and let Mike sit here. Mike.
Oh, he didn't die.
Come on.
So Mike, I didn't know. No one switched. Dan, he wants to shake your hand. That was tough. No. We did pretty well for you, man. I got to be honest, but that was fun. All right.
Great.
I don't know if you heard his pitch. We're talking to Prometheus pitch. He gave a very good pitch.
My pitch is Alien at the Dawn of Time. Two warring clans of humans have to unite, invent fire to fight off the first alien ever on Earth.
And Rob
I did the space over.
Space hangover with aliens. So now you have a chance. You're here.
Sure.
I'll let you get a shot. Because you did drive through a lot of traffic to get here.
Yeah, it was very stressful. first 40 minutes of WALL-E is what I'm thinking about. It's beautiful. We're getting to see the universe. We're getting to see this little creature and what it's doing, how it's living its life. And you sort of start to go, oh, this thing is such a sweet, sweet little character. It's like a perfect...
The xenomorph we're seeing.
Like, yes, okay, yes, yeah. Yeah, exactly. And we're getting just like a beautiful piece. There's no dialogue. There's nothing. It's just a pure piece of cinema. It's wonderful. And we really start to feel for this thing. Eventually, it falls in love with, I don't know, a little... It could be an E.T.-like creature. I don't know. It doesn't have to be. But it could be some sort of cute thing. And we go, oh, wow, this is a relationship. We're feeling for this character now. And at a certain point, it all goes wrong like it always has to go. And that thing eats his girlfriend. It's vicious. We see the beginning of this thing being just a ruthless bastard that it's going to be.
Ain't that the truth?
Hell yeah.
Bah, with the bah, to bang, to dang. At the end of it is it putting on a trench coat. My name is Kit.
Dandrick
this
water.
Time I'm gonna let it all come out.
All right, I think Mike's at a disadvantage because Max gave a very good pitch. You didn't get to hear it. I'm gonna call it to Max. I think Max gave a very interesting thing. Dan, what do the commenters think? you're like, I'm just checking.
How'd you get over there?
I don't know. If I'm being 100% honest, I am still pulling up hashtag Movie Fights Live, which is where you can comment about what's going on.
Oh, live TV. All right. Well, I hope they liked it because I liked it, Max. I wish you had given the real answer because that answer was silly. But that was funny. So thank you for the joke.
I mean,
yours was close. You missed a very, very, very good pitch coming after. But it's all right.
That's fine.
Puts Max automatically in the finals.
Dude, I bummed myself out with that.
Yeah.
I want to see like a fucking 19-year-old cavewoman with a spear showing down with an alien in like a pit, like in a forest that's all on fire so badly right now. Directed by Ridley Scott, that scene would be incredible.
So you have, it's 3-1. This is the final round. We're moving to 5 rounds to try and get through these faster, and we have after the fights. Wow, look at this. So some of you are going to be annoyed with me, but that's just the way it's got to go to keep us speeding. So, Mike, there's one more round here. If you get this round, you'll tie with Rob, and we'll be able to do a tiebreaker for the finals. Max, you automatically move on the finals, so you can take this one seriously. I'm sure you will because you're a fighter, or you can do whatever you want on this one because the points, well, they will matter at the end, but just so you understand, you're in the finals.
Oh, hell yeah.
All right, round 5, here we go. Rody R. asked us a fun question. If you could visit one restaurant or bar from any movie in real life, where do you go and what do you do? What do you have?
A little typo in that tweet.
Did it? Oh, yeah. Come on, Rody. Get your typos out of there. All right. Mike, we get to start with you now that you're finally here. You're going to lead us off.
Yeah, I was laughing because I remember, this is the one I'm going to lose when I was looking at it. So
Do you want to reevaluate?
Yeah, let somebody else go. Let me reevaluate.
Let's reevaluate. Yeah. Rob, go ahead.
I got this one. I like this one a lot. I was trying to think of a really good restaurant from a movie, something different, something fun, something that would isn't just, oh, they have good food, or, oh, it's the Pulp Fiction one, so someone's going to get murdered there. Like, an actual interesting, fascinating place. And I went with the Italian restaurant on Lady and the Tramp, and this is why. Everyone knows the scene where they eat the spaghetti and meatballs out in the back alley. That guy is clearly insane. The manager of that restaurant is clearly an insane person. He has a very long conversation with stray dogs behind his restaurant. He sets up a candlelight dinner for them and feeds them their silverware next to it, a plate of spaghetti and meatballs, then brings an accordion out and serenades two stray dogs. And like is telling his cook, we gotta get something good, we gotta get something good. If he does that for random stray dogs behind his restaurant, imagine what kind of life-changing experience it is for a human being to eat at his restaurant. Wow. I want to eat there right now. It sounds incredible.
All right, Max, what do you got?
I went through three to get here. First, I was like, well, clearly Mos Eisley Cantina, and then I realized I'm not a tough guy. Luke almost gets raped. I'm not tougher even than Luke. And Luke was a pussy. I don't want to get raped. My friend doesn't like you. Then the next one I thought of was Be Our Guest, was the Beast's dining room, because that food looks so good. And then I realized for them to be furniture, it would have to be during the Reign of the Rose, and the Beast would still be the Beast, and me being there would probably end badly for me, because I'm not a hot brunette. Or am I? And I landed on, do you remember in my first movie fight, I won on a technicality, which is Spencer was like, I want to go to Hogwarts. And I was like, there are all these spells protecting Hogwarts.
Oh, I remember.
From humans. So you just get mind wiped and kicked out. You know where there aren't those spells? A town called Hogsmeade. Bar called the Three Broomsticks. I want butterbeer. I'm going to go in. I'm not going to make eye contact with anybody. There's nothing. You can't tell a muggle just by looking at him. Most wizards can't. They never say that in the books, I don't think. And so I'm going to go in. I'm going to get my butterbeer. I'm going to sit down, and I'm just going to people watch. I'm going to people watch for 3.5 hours, and then I'm going to head out into Hogsmeade. I'm going to go up the high street. I'm going to go about 200 yards to where I can get the view over the lake of Hogwarts. I'm going to take it in. I'm going to go. I'm going to get in my rental Prius. I'm going to drive back out of North England, and I'm going to drive back to London, and I'm going to get really drunk. I'm going to hang out with my friend Amelia. She's going to be like, did you get the butterbeer? I'm going to be like, yes. She's going to be like, how good was it? I'll be like, it's so-so, but like, it sounds better than it is. She's going to be like, do you want to go to Wizarding World of Harry Potter when you're in LA? Next time I'm like, no. Here's pictures of me at the real Three Broomsticks. I don't need to go to your Bobo bullshit theme park nothing, you stupid bitch. But I won't say that to her because she's one of my good friends. It'll be in a metaphor that you stupid bitch won't be her. It'll be the whole world that didn't get to go with me.
Because you thought that.
I'm going to say something.
Yeah.
I am going to bring Rob.
Yes. Oh. Okay. Rob, you're in. Mike, you had some time to digest.
I digested and I was thinking about it.
Did you switch your answer or are you keeping the same?
I did not switch my answer.
Okay, I was just
my
curious.
Answer is the same. So here's the thing. I like consistency. I like chain restaurants. I like things that I know what I'm getting.
Oh, this is a great answer.
I know what I'm getting, okay? That's why McDonald's is so popular. That's why all these things are so popular. So because of that, I want to go somewhere where I know the meal is going to be good and where the vibe is going to be fun and relaxed, which is why Margaritaville Isla Nublar in Jurassic World. That's where I want to go and why I want to eat, okay? Here it is. It's a cool place. There are dinosaurs there already. But more importantly, there is a consistent meal called the Cheeseburger in Paradise and the Last Mango in Paris drink that you can have. I've had it twice. I've had it once in Vegas, once in Orlando, and it's great both times, okay? I love Jimmy Buffett. I love what he's all about. And here's the added thing. Jimmy Buffett is the bartender at this Margaritaville, okay? Oh. You get to meet the guy. He's the guy, and he's there. He's in the movie. He's making drinks. He's running from dinosaurs. It's fun. This seems like the ultimate place, and I know that the meal I'm going to get is going to be good.
Okay, I have a thing. First of all, two things.
Sure.
First of all, two things. Thing number one,
I don't know if you know this, but Jurassic World sales have been down, like, huge. They don't have any new dinosaurs. It's all the same old shit. And second of all, they're trying to cover it up. But, like, just this summer, there was, like, this huge fucking incident where, like, I think a woman died and, like, a bunch of people got injured because, like, the fucking bird dinosaur, pteranodon, there was, like, a helicopter crash. And they're, like, covering it up because of all the fucking military supplement ties. But they've been closed, and it's not for renovations. I have heard there was actually a serious problem.
Do you believe those rumors, Mike?
First of all, I don't believe those rumors. Jimmy Buffett wouldn't put his name on something and put it in a park that was unsafe. He's just not that kind of guy.
Jimmy Buffett's on tour right now. He left that gig.
I saw him at the Hollywood Bowl. I know he's on tour.
So Jimmy Buffett is like your bartender there?
Well, in the movie, he's
a guy. That's why I don't want to go to
what
this movie? Point.
What? Jurassic World.
Jurassic World isn't a movie. It's real life. This is which would you visit in real life. And Jurassic World just had a very serious incident.
You know who didn't have a very serious incident? The Italian restaurant on Lady and the Tramp.
The only way I know about Jurassic World is because if you go to the Margaritaville website and click on Isla Nublar, which is an actual thing you can do right now, it shows Jimmy Buffett. I don't know about the movie. All I know is that it just references it in that in the website. So I'm not acknowledging any sort of reality.
Both of your restaurants sound really busy and crowded. My restaurant is so, there's no wait whatsoever.
Am I eating, and are we eating inside the restaurant, or are we eating in the alleyway
in
behind?
In the dining room, because this is all going on after hours outside.
So we're not eating by the trash cans.
Of course not.
Well, that's the fun thing, though. We want to see Lady and the Tramp eating.
You
we want to see this man talking to animals.
Spaghetti in an alley?
I don't want to do that, but I'm
My
saying...
My first date was just like...
Is there a window, though? I mean, I'm going to tell you that's too helpful, I guess. Is there at least a window we can watch the crazy
no,
man talk
No, you get
to,
be the dogs.
No. Serenaded. None of this. The dogs aren't even, they're out back. You're in the restaurant, but you're getting to interact with this insane man that makes spaghetti and a fine meal for dogs. Imagine what he would do for you. Like, imagine what he would do for a person.
He might hate humans,
though. He's doing all this for a dog.
Oh, hell yeah. He's anti-human.
He's just sad and wants anyone around and will
thoughts
do
on
anything.
Any, thoughts on Hogsmeade here?
Thoughts on Hogsmeade. Butterbeer, I've had the version from the theme parks. It's just like it's a nice soda. That's about it. And like it would be cool to go there, but you're not getting like you're not going to be guaranteed to see Harry there or any of the other people. The most famous characters.
Harry. I want to see Dumbledore's brother and the bartender and like... And just they're gonna be underage kids running in and out, so you know I'm down with that. No, wait a minute. Whoa. It also places me in the wizarding world of Harry Potter, and the fact that I'm there definitely implies, as a Muggle, I might be an important character later.
But it's like one of the most like unimpressive places in that wizarding world. Like I'd much rather go to the candy store or the wine store.
Yeah, but I get caught instantly as a Muggle in Diagon Alley.
I don't want to go somewhere that there's a chance. I could get kicked out. I could get people angry at me. I want to go somewhere that's relaxing.
Rob, I've hung
There's
out with you.
There's a man playing an accordion.
We've hung out.
There's a man playing an accordion, and there's fine Italian food.
What do you guys think? Is that fine Italian food?
It looked good, but we won't know because spaghetti looks good no matter how bad it is. Let's be honest.
If I wasn't reading all these fucking BuzzFeed articles about like, oh, fucking Gintac does it again, like the terrible incident, one woman dead, Jurassic World. Like if I wasn't reading all these fucking articles, of course I want to go to Jurassic World, but how am I supposed to afford that? My parents are getting divorced.
Look,
yeah, Jurassic World, it's going to cost me tens of thousands of dollars.
No, it doesn't. $7,000 to get there.
But I mean, then.
But the cheeseburger paradise is like $11.95.
You're talking about food, souvenirs, all this stuff. You're looking at $10,000 easy.
I'm just.
All right, this is. I'm trying to make a. I guess I can pick one. Give me one last closing for why the other two suck, Max.
The other two suck because one is potentially a boring, normal Italian food in New York experience, and the other, I mean, the place is closed. It's closed. They're like talking about lawsuits. Apparently, like some woman like tried to like design a new type of dinosaur. It has military ties. The whole thing seems like Benghazi Republican weird shit.
Rob, final thought.
One of these, a noseless man, could come in and murder you at any moment.
That is a problem.
And the other one is a tourist attraction. You might as well go to Cheesecake Factory at that point.
Mike.
First of all, Cheesecake Factory is great, and if there was a Cheesecake Factory in Isla Nublar, I would have chosen that. But I don't know that there is.
It's a very big menu.
It's a huge, it's amazing. It's got everything you could possibly want.
We
it's
have
incredible.
Everything and we do nothing good.
Uh-huh. Okay, I mean, look, these places I would like to go. If we're just talking about seeing an insane man, there's plenty of places in my hometown of Schaumburg, Illinois, where you can go watch a weird manager act weird to people. And as far as that, the Hog's Head, it's fine. But here, at Margaritaville, you get to see all these great things. You get to see a cool raptor trainer that wears jean jackets and he rides a motorcycle and he's like a 15-year-old's idea of what a cool guy is, and you get to see him go by and you get to see all these cool things, and in addition you get a meal that is consistent, that is American, and is delicious every time.
I've been to Margaritaville in Orlando,
it's
Florida,
great, I know.
And it is a nightmare.
A great nightmare.
All right, Dan, what are they saying over there? I assume you're online now. Movie
yes.
Fights Live.
Movie Fights, hashtag Movie Fights Live. More like people suggesting their own options. I don't see a large... a lot of people have mentioned the restaurant from Ratatouille.
Oh, man, why didn't I think of the Rat-storant? I feel like an idiot right now.
A lot of Star Wars love for either Maz Kanata's or the Cantina from the...
These are dangerous places. You want to, like, go to a dive bar in Compton?
One of my favorites would be Emmanuel at Mannystein 18 wants to visit the Double Deuce from Roadhouse, which would be quite a trip.
That's also scary.
I hear that bartender is no longer there.
James, I'm activating you. What do you think out of these? Which one would appeals to you as the fan here?
Honestly, I'd have to go with Isla Nublar. I mean, it's dangerous, I know, Max, but dinosaurs.
And Jimmy Buffett.
I love that your selling point for Isla Nublar was consistency.
Right.
Yeah, so here's where I'm struggling, because I think yours is actually dangerous.
Mine is not dangerous. There's never an incident in the town of Hogsmeade.
Well, we don't spend a lot of time there.
Yeah, we do. We spend a lot of time going in and out of Hogsmeade.
You didn't sell me fully, so I'm just... and for the sake of also... these two were this is where I went to, and then... Strange Man or Jimmy Buffett Bartender.
It's the same thing.
It really is the same thing. But I'm going to let James help me on that one. Mike, if you swayed the fan and I'm on the fence, Mike gets it. Wow.
The health code
I didn't think
violation.
You'd do that.
Man, if Mike had been here the whole time, maybe he'd be winning.
Violations.
Now, all that does is create a tiebreaker for Mike and Rob.
Mm-hmm. You know, I wrote a movie called Margaritaville.
Did you?
Yeah, it's a script I wrote when I was like 20. It's about a place where it's almost like the island in Peter Pan, or in Pinocchio, where you can get stuck and all your cares go away. And it's this perfect tropical island.
No Jimmy Buffett, though.
Oh, no, it's all the Jimmy Buffett songs.
Oh, good.
There are land sharks.
Every character is played by Jimmy Buffett.
There's only one character. It is Jimmy Buffett. It's a video of him telling you the story.
Before we go to the speed round, that means we have to now do a tiebreaker. We weren't supposed to have these with this new 5-round system, but we managed to have it. Here we go. I'm right on the score, right? That is right so far?
Max has 3, Rob and Mike both have 1.
Okay, so this is the tiebreaker. The winner of this tiebreaker will move on to our speed round. Here we go. Worst performance ever. To be clarification, because you haven't tested this. I'm making sure I'm clear. Speed round, you'll each have 15 seconds, the way this works, and the tiebreaker is the same rules. I'm going to name a question. You both have to answer an answer quickly. Whoever says their answer first gets to pick that answer. If you say it second, you'll have to pick another answer. Makes sense? And you'll each have 15 seconds and 5-second follow-ups. So listen to the question and spurt out as quickly as you can the right answer. Here we go.
Spurt out the mic.
Spurt out.
Spurt it. Oh, my mic. Oh, you already spurted. Spurted. Your mic got left.
I spurted early.
Happens to me all the time.
All right. Sorry. Bad choice of a word. Here we go. Here's the question. Worst performance ever by any actor in a superhero movie?
Ryan Reynolds and Green Lantern. He didn't even care.
Okay, hold on. Save your... Yeah, I just need the answer, and then we'll get into it. So we have Ryan Reynolds and Mike.
Ben Affleck and Daredevil.
Ooh. Okay, we have Ryan Reynolds.
I disagree with
Ben
that.
With both, or we'll see. Don't say yet. Okay, 15 seconds for Rob. Since you were first, Ryan Reynolds in Green Lantern. Why was he the worst? Go ahead.
He didn't even care about that movie. He had no interest in being in it. I don't even know if he's read the comics. He was just so bored in it. Felt like a cardboard cutout. And no one likes that movie whatsoever. He was awful in it.
Okay, 15 seconds for Mike. Go ahead.
Ben Affleck is just, it's flat. It's like the biggest crime, I think, in any of this stuff is just when you're flat and unmemorable. Like, it's one of the greatest characters, one of my favorite characters of all time, and he just did literally nothing with it. And I think Affleck is a decent actor, but, like, if he has no material to work with, it just sinks it.
5-second rebuttal, Mike. I'm sorry, Rob.
I thought Daredevil was great, and clearly it was good because now he's Batman.
Mike, 5-second rebuttal.
Greenlander, Ryan Reynolds is at least, like, watchable. He's got a thing. Like, I know what his personality is, and that's at least... I mean, it's a terrible...
I was hoping you would say, well, Ryan Reynolds is now Deadpool, and then we'd be like, oh,
that would have been good. That would have been a good thing.
And we'd have to kill ourselves.
All right, we have to base this on the argument, so Dan and James, I'm going to activate you to help me tiebreak this. Dan...
I think I should actually recuse myself, because...
Oh, you're involved.
I'm technically Mike, so...
James, I need your help here.
Oh, that's tough.
Based on their arguments.
I gotta go with Green Lantern. Based on his argument, yeah, his performance was flat. It was just not there.
That's the same thing Mike said, which I thought about Ben Affleck.
Have you seen the director's cut of Daredevil?
No.
Yeah.
Ben Affleck's kind of good.
I don't mind Ben Affleck.
He didn't say that, and he didn't say that.
I'm not the one deciding the argument.
I got to decide, and then we can argue about it, and we'll do more after the fight. Based on what I heard, you did sneak it in there that that's sort of what Ryan Reynolds' character is, and you said that Ben Affleck was just sort of wasted and terrible material. So that's where I got hung up, because you both said
Hal
flat.
Jordan is not boring and flat. Hal Jordan is a womanizing, cocky ladies' man who's funny and cool.
Again, I've got to base on these arguments. We will argue. It's not about what I think. It's about what I heard.
Okay,
and what I heard here was that I heard flat and boring from both of you, and neither of them cared. But I heard Ryan Reynolds at least is fun and attempted to try, which is what Mike said, because I agree Hal Jordan isn't boring, and at least Ryan Reynolds tries, what I heard. Ryan Reynolds is an interesting fellow at the end, is what sold me near the end. So, Mike, I'm overruling James. I'm going to give Mike the point.
But Daredevil was supposed to be fun? He's not. He's
no,
a blind.
Green Lantern, he's saying, was supposed to be fun. Because he said at the end that Ryan Reynolds...
Was he fun, though?
He's more fun than Ben Affleck.
What? What?
Based on the argument, you came out with a little bit at the end that defended why Reynolds was bad. You both gave me bad answers of why they were bad, but that's what happened. Mike got the point.
They were both bad answers.
They were both bad answers. They were both not great. But your rebuttal helped me at the end. You didn't give me enough on why Ben Affleck was worse than Ryan Reynolds. His take on why Reynolds was worse.
I believe
was what
we
sold
said
me.
The exact same thing.
You did in the beginning. That's very true.
I want to take this opportunity to apologize for interrupting you.
No, you were allowed. I was a tough one. I still want to use your judgments to help me because I'm trying
to. Very
excited. I think I was clear based on what I heard. Whether I was wrong or not, we'll talk after the fight. But Rob, you were wonderful. Thank you so much. I want you to come back. Very funny stuff. You were awesome. I hope you had fun. You're going to help me now decide the winner here because we're going to go in the speed round with Max and Mike.
What if I won?
That'd be incredible.
Max would be really
pissed. I usually lose at things.
I'm bad at this.
Before we go to the speed round, Dan, I need you to help me one last time thank our wonderful sponsors over at Loot Crate. Get yourself some awesome gear and support this podcast in the process. Click the annotation and visit lootcrate.com/moviefights. Sign up and you'll save 10% on a new subscription by using code MOVIEFIGHTS. Dan has some of the cool stuff, the multipass, the alien plushie, the X-Files shirt he's wearing, Space Invaders, lots of everything themed every month. And next month is the Dead Crate, so if you subscribe by 2:19 at 9 p.m. Pacific Standard, you will subscribe for the Dead Crate, which has Deadpool, Walking Dead, and so much more stuff. So thank you, Loot Crate, as always. All right, guys, are you ready? We're in the speed round. Whoo! As we just told, you'll each have 15 seconds. If you say the same answer at the same time, it's whoever said it first. Are we all ready?
Yes.
Oh, Max is getting really ready.
He's very ready.
Wow.
Woo! All right. Camera's gonna have to adjust to you. This is all right. Good work, Ryan. He's on it.
He's taking the straps down, as they say in wrestling.
Nice.
Kurt Angle.
Here we go. All right, guys. Speed round number one. Best movie with the word old in the title.
Yeah.
Old Boy.
No Country for No Men. No Country for Old Men.
Old Boy versus No Country for Old Men. Okay.
I said Old Country for No Men.
I heard Mike first.
That's a different one.
And Max is second. So Max, Old Boy. Mike, Old Boy, clarify which one you're referring to.
The good one.
Okay. Original Old Boy. Go ahead, 15 seconds. When you start.
It's a beautiful work of art. It's like one of the greatest movies of all time. It's just from an aesthetic standpoint, it's beautiful. The fights in it are just so well staged. It's so memorable. I blanked.
All right, 15 seconds for Max. Whenever you start.
No Country for Old Men was a game changer for the Coen brothers. It leveled them up to an even higher place than they were. It's a masterpiece of tension and evocative storytelling. Javier Bardem as Anton Chigurh is one of the most iconic film characters of all time. Old Boy, while a fantastic movie, is ultimately just a fantastic movie.
5 second rebuttal,
Mike. Just a fantastic movie is pretty good. No Country for Old Men is great, but there's other movies that are better in the Coen brothers' output. It's just something we remember because they were in Dry Spell.
Max, 5 second rebuttal.
One hammer fight and a cool premise does not make it better than No Country for Old Men.
Okay. Rob, I'm going to need your help here. Based on the arguments you heard, which one did you like the best?
I mean, I got to go with Max just because it was a more cohesive argument. and then I thought the points were a little stronger.
Fair enough, James.
Agreed.
I think we all three agreed. Mike, if you had just not stumbled there, you might have gotten there better. Max got the first point.
I stumbled.
I love Old Boy. This is a must-win point for Mike.
So he's got to win all four. He's got to win all four.
Okay.
To win.
It's been
all
done,
four
actually,
win.
I think, hasn't it?
It's been close.
Close. Yeah. All right, we have a visual aid that's going to pop up on the TV that Max can't see. Can we lose that?
I had them take away the screen because during the Star Wars one, I caught myself looking at
myself.
There we
go. Can you see the screen now?
And I hate that.
Can you see the screen now?
Yeah, okay. I can see it.
Here we go. We have a visual aid. When I tell you to, don't do it yet. Sonny Dominguez on Twitter sent us this bargain bin pick. These two movies are going to be in the bargain bin. Which one should you buy? And let's see it. Dinner for Schmucks or Couples Retreat?
Couples Retreat.
Okay. Mike got Couples Retreat. That means Max, you're stuck with Dinner for Schmucks. Okay. Couples Retreat, Max. I'm sorry, Mike. 15 seconds. Go ahead.
A Couples Retreat, because you can really neither are good, but you can see a two guys like Vince Vaughn and Jon Favreau how far they've fallen, and you can just be fascinated by it because these were swingers. These were the coolest guys ever, and now they're making like the lamest couples movie of all time. It's just fascinating to watch what happens to the American man.
15 seconds for Max. Dinner for Schmucks.
In the 1940s, promoters determined that it was more exciting if the outcomes of certain fights were fixed, building dramatic tension. Therefore, they began to rig fights to create tension and suspense.
5 second rebuttal, Mike.
Dinner for Schmucks is bad. It's very bad and unwatchable.
Max, 5 second rebuttal.
This art form is often called professional wrestling, but we're doing it today in this fight. I refuse to answer this question because I don't want the fight to end.
All right. Based on those arguments, I think we can call Mike the winner on that one.
Yeah.
Are you going to PWG next week?
No, because Coen didn't get me tickets because he doesn't do that anymore because he's mad at me.
That's upsetting.
All right, you got to get the next three, Mike. You're still on the board.
Okay.
Number three. What is the worst Coen Brothers movie?
Lady Killers.
I need a second opinion.
Can
on
we rewind it to see who got it?
Lady Killers.
No, let's ask them on the audience. Please chime in quick. What did you guys hear? I really heard it at the exact same time.
I did too.
I'm hearing.
I heard louder, but I really heard them at the exact same time. Did anyone have a definitive ear that's not have a?
I'm hearing no. Max.
Burn After
from
Reading
here.
Is the only other one. But
anyone else?
It was the.
I think that's too
the
close to call. I'm gonna cut the question and ask a new question. Man. Is that fair?
That was cool. Though. That was good. I like you.
I don't feel confident that we heard it enough, and sadly we can't play it back because
we're
live.
No, I'm staring at myself on the fucking. I knew I.
He's gonna push it back. Ryan's got you covered. All right. Luckily, I have another.
Such a narcissist.
I have another extra question if we need it. All right. Here we go.
Just because I look like
I apologize.
I look like a toucan whenever I see
the
Coen's
movie.
No.
That's not what I'm apologizing for. Okay. You'll see in a second. Number four. What would be the dream director for a good Power Rangers movie?
Oh, you motherfucker.
Who would be the good director?
Oh, James Cameron.
Edgar Wright.
All right. James Cameron versus Edgar Wright. All right. And I heard James Cameron first. Max, that means it's you. Go ahead.
James Cameron is a master at building action sequences with heartfelt characters you care about. I personally, as someone who was involved for a long time in something like this, feel that this movie should not just be another summer action movie.
Fair. Okay, you got it in there, Mike?
Power Rangers is obviously a cheesy thing that we like, but it's not nothing that was ever really great. Edgar Wright is perfect at blending humor, action, tongue-in-cheek stuff, stuff that's all going to blend together and make something that's not only just fun and good action, but it's going to be interesting, and it's going to be even better than the actual source material.
Five-second rebuttal.
Edgar Wright is not comfortable working with properties at this level. He quit Ant-Man.
Great, 5 second rebuttal, Max or Mike. When you start,
when he was saying James Cameron. James Cameron used to be very good at putting characters that we liked and stuff, but he hasn't done it lately.
James, I'm gonna come to you. You're the fan. You were listening intently. What do you think there?
I gotta go with Max. I mean, I'm actually very much a fan, and
I want it to be good.
It needs to be good.
It doesn't need to be Transformers.
I don't understand, though, why he gave me a little bit more as to what Edgar Wright would bring. You got hung up on it needs to be good and didn't tell me why Cameron needed to be good.
I didn't have time.
I didn't hear it. So I'm stuck with, I got to go with Edgar Wright based on that argument. Rob, you're the tiebreaker now. What do you think based on the arguments?
I don't know.
If you don't make a call, then I'm going to have to overrule, but I'm allowing you. Are you giving in?
I don't know. I can't.
Based on the arguments.
I can't do this.
It's tough, right?
I can't do this one.
He's out. He's calling himself out.
Yep.
James, are you siding with me or am I overruling? You still stand by your fight.
I still stand by my fight.
Okay, and I just got to do it as the judge, so I'm going to overrule that one. And since Rob didn't put a vote in, that means Mike wins that one. Mm-hmm. Whoo, shit.
I like it.
Hachi machi.
All right. Here we go. Best Ben Stiller comedy.
Zoolander.
Best Ben Stiller comedy.
Meet the Parents?
What? What the fuck, Tropic Thunder, you fucking weirdo?
Seriously.
Fucking hard. It's hard. Flirting with disaster.
I don't really like Tropic Thunder.
It's hard.
All right.
Little one.
It's hard.
I don't really think you're weird. I just seem very passionate.
Hey.
All right, I heard Zoolander first. Don't get cocky. Zoolander, you can win this.
Zoolander,
15 seconds when you start.
Zoolander is a damn near perfect movie. It takes a premise that sounds like it's going to be fucking, like, grown-ups and turns it into a heartfelt, evocative, action-packed, funny, and ultimately very smart movie that is accessible to everyone, not just a normal comedy audience.
Meet the Parents.
We're speaking of accessible. Meet the Parents is a movie that everyone loves. We're talking old people. We're talking lamos. We're talking weirdos. We're talking everybody likes Meet the Parents, and it's the thing that finally broke Ben Stiller like huge, massive, in a mainstream way. And if something connects with a larger audience, there is a lot of validity to it. Zoolander is a good movie. It's funny, but
5 second rebuttal, Max.
None of your arguments are real. It's a down the middle movie, and something about Mary broke Ben Stiller in a mainstream way. And on top.
Sorry. None of this is real. This is all an illusion. It's our consciousness is also an illusion.
Oh my God, you're still Dan!
He interrupted. You get 2 more seconds, Mike.
Oh, and it's watch it again. It's really funny.
All right, Rob, based on the arguments.
I gotta go with Max just based on the fact that something about Mary was the one that broke Ben Stiller.
That would have been a good Ben Stiller choice, too.
Would have been great.
James.
Flirting with disaster is great.
James, yeah, based on the arguments.
I gotta go with Max as well. I mean, took him down.
I don't disagree. I think it was close. It was close, but Max did win that argument. That puts Max in the win. Max,
he's in the win.
You won your second movie fights. Congratulations. That was a crazy episode, Dan. What do you think of that episode? That's one for the record books.
Not what I expected when I came in today. But, Mike, I feel badly because you do well on pitches, and I feel like you might have taken one of those first two rounds. And I feel like I failed you.
You did your best.
Arriving late, I feel like maybe he's great.
He's really good. Mike is a very good fighter. And, Mike, I'm sorry there was a miscommunication, whatever happened. Please come back. We'll make sure you come back with enough time in the next one. But thank you for driving so fast over here.
I broke many laws.
Mike Carlson at Fat Carlson on Twitter. Anything you'd like to plug?
Trade Star Wars cards with me on the Star Wars Card Trader app. I'm Fat Carlson, PHATCARLSON.
Rob Fee, what a wonderful debut. I was a huge fan. Very funny stuff. I hope you had fun.
I did.
At so, Rob Fee on Twitter. Anything else you'd like us to check out?
If you follow me on there, you'll see everything else.
Love it. That's a good place to find everything. Max Landis, once again, bringing the thunder at up to my knees on Twitter. What else do you got cooking? American Alien still in stores?
American Alien has four more issues. My Superman comic that I'm very proud of. The next one comes out, I believe, next week. And please go buy it and buy the first three if you haven't. My movie that I wrote, Mr. Right, with Sam Rockwell and Anna Kendrick, comes out in April. The movie I directed, Me, Him, Her, is very weird, and maybe you'll love it, or maybe you'll be like, what the fuck is this? And it comes out in March, and I think you'll love it, I hope. And then my TV show, Channel Zero, comes on this Halloween on Sci-Fi Channel, and then my TV show, Dirk Gently, ideally comes out in the fall on BBC America. Please watch all of them. Thank you for inviting me back. This
Dude,
is so fun.
Thank you for fitting it in with all that schedule. You're like The Rock.
No. I'm dying.
You're busy, I know. It's
this win emotionally means more to me than anything that's happened in 2 months.
Well, you're welcome back anytime. Dan Murrell on the couch. Murrell, Dan, thanks for stepping in. Mike, right. You did a good job, I got to say.
Thank you, yeah.
It was very entertaining.
I did my best.
For coming in so late.
Dan Murrell, anything you'd like to plug?
Hashtag Botanicus.
Yes.
God bless.
Can't forget that. James, did you have fun on the show?
Oh, absolutely.
That was a fun one to watch.
Yes, this was great.
Thank you for that belt. Very cool of you. And thank you all at home for watching. Andy Signore on Twitter, on Instagram, all that jazz. We will be back. If they can stick around, they will be as well. We'll find out. It's been a long day. But after the fight's right here next live, you guys can call in. Mike, I'm hoping you'll stick and actually fight some of those things that you didn't get to fight.
Sure, yeah.
So we'll see what happens. Student right next for after the fight if you're watching SG Plus. Otherwise, see you next time. Thank you guys for watching. Oh, and don't forget, Knocking Dead, 1 p.m. Monday on Screen Junkies Plus. Thank you guys for watching. Have a great one.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.